Good morning. Good morning, Bangalore.
Good morning.
Good morning. See, it's as simple as that. The energy which you have there is what will translate into a conversation over here. So I need to hear that little bit of like cheer, disagreement, agreement, applause, as and when you feel like it. Cool? So thank you. Today we have a very, very quite exciting panel along with us and a quite an interesting topic as well. Filled with experts and leaders in different categories. Talking about customer experience which drives brand success is a little tricky in an era where you look at what is actually a brand success. Because we have legacy brands which has been built over loyalty. And today when you're talking about a customer experience, we are talking about personalization at a larger scale. We are talking about a small thing where even a coffee served cold becomes a problem in terms of a customer experience. So we have a panelist which is like across different industries. So maybe I'll start off with Ankur and then across everybody with a opening question. In your industry, how has customer experience evolved over the last couple of decades?
So what has happened in the last many decades is that consumer has been evolving. The way we as a company, so I represent TTK Prestige, so we as a company largely serve the homemaker. Now that homemaker can be a male, female, growing up kid, anyone. We don't define it as, it's no gender, so we say cooking has no gender, right? So how the consumers have evolved, we all have seen in our households that at a certain point in time, our moms used to be the driving factor. Our husbands used to be the decision-making factor. In late 90s, we have seen the evolution happening with more and more women coming in the picture. They became the decision-maker. In the last decade or so, we are seeing that it is co-opted. Okay, every decision, most of the time people spend at home today is in kitchen or going to sleep, right? So it's become more and more. So the consumers have been changing. Brands, as per, has been changing as the times have evolved, right? So that's what my take is on that, that today it's no more an individual decision. It's a decision that people take as per the circumstances. It's the decision that the convenience, health, and a lot of other factors which define the chores of the day is what makes them take a decision in whatever they engage with, whichever brand they engage with, whichever product they engage with. So that's my take.
So for healthcare, I like to say from a time where somebody had to travel to a metro city to find out a doctor, relevant doctor, to an experience now that we're talking about is having a five-star experiences. So the industry has grown leaps and bounds in terms of giving giving the right experience to the consumers because they're asking for it. But apart from that, I think what beautifully has happened is healthcare is the only industry where the personalization is the requirement. There is nothing without having the personalization because your disease management cannot be different or say similar to anyone else. So personalization happens at scale at that point in time. So this industry has moved leaps and bounds over, I think, last three decades.
See, we come from CPaaS. CPaaS stands for Communication Platform as a Service. So what we have seen is everything becomes conversation for us, right? Ashish mentioned, right, Metro. What we have seen today, we tried busting the queues, right? Today we have launched, we are the largest processor of Metro tickets today in India. The way we are doing it, a passenger can reach out to a brand on a WhatsApp channel. He can identify which station he has to go. Yes, he can book the tickets. Okay, he can make the payments. Everything he can do seamlessly on one interface, right? So it has become very conversation, okay? And now every consumer wants to connect to a brand the way he's connecting with your family members, right? That is the level which is going today, and you have to be there. It's kind of, I would say, a living, breathing framework is what we have felt, right? Today, market is evolving, consumer is evolving, technology is evolving. Everywhere it is getting evolved, and when consumer is trying to connect with the brand, is expecting a similar experience, his aspirations are going high. Okay, that is where we feel that omnichannel experience from our point of view is playing a very pivotal role, okay, when it comes to engaging.
That's really interesting. So when it comes to location-based advertising, we are the experts when it comes to using the power of location. With the power of location, we can actually curate, customize, and personalize experiences for our brands, for our users. We get to know their consumer behavior, their preferences, their patterns. We get to know the value of high individuals. We actually figure out what can work best for what kind of user. Just to cite an example, looking at auto industry per se, there was this one campaign that we had run for an auto brand where the brand wanted to reach out to different users from different states and vernacular languages. So each and every communication was customized and personalized for them in their own language, be it Gujarati, be it Marathi, be it Hindi, be it English. So those messages and those personalized experiences led to a lot of footfall in their dealership. So I totally agree with what all of you guys are saying, that personalization really helps when it comes to understanding the consumer behavior, understanding what can we customize for them, and at the end of the day drive more business for the particular brand per se.
Hello everyone, my name is Vanda. I'm a consumer marketer, and over the last 18 years I've had a bird's eye view of cross section of industries, which is food, beauty and personal care and retail. And what I've seen in the last 18 years is consumers are changing. You need to delight them, you need to awe them, because this ultimately builds loyalty and drives business, as you said. And I think one example I can give you is, this was at my time, right? I was working at Licious, and it's meat and seafood, right? What kind of customization, personalization, how can you awe the consumer, right? It's the same meat, the chicken which you get in the chicken shop, and you get it online, it's the same. But there comes the opportunity to do something different and really delight the consumer. And credit to Licious, they did the unthinkable. At that point of time, the boxes which we deliver to consumers, right? So if you ordered, for example, 1/2 kilo chicken, it came in boxes which actually had the face of a person. For example, it's Vanda. She's from Goa. She likes chicken wings. It actually had a face on it. At that point of time, right, from a commodity to actually creating a brand, this went a huge step in that direction, because you actually made it something lovable, interesting, and we had, I think, around 20 odd stories on these boxes, and every time a consumer actually got this, right, there was something interesting about it. So I think this is about delighting the consumers, telling them something which is completely unexpectable. And this was called out, really, really loudly, as a differentiation of the brand. The other brand I worked on was at Fresh to Home, again, a meat and seafood brand. And there was so much the brand did, in giving the best fish, the best chicken, but no one really knew. So you actually have a bag which tells the story of shore to door, or from farm to fork, with lovely illustrations, with a QR code there which could actually scan and open the microsite and tell the story. So these small things go a long way in actually building the brand, building relevance, and creating that unique spot in the consumer's mind. So I think these were a couple of examples which came to my mind.
Yeah, hi, I'm Pavandeep, I'm from Rapido. We are the company, or we are the brand which moves India. We move Bharat. We do about 2 million rides a day across the country, across our three categories, bike, taxi, autos, and cabs. And yes, we are in cabs, so. I think this is one category because, you have folks here who are in want category. We are in the need category, we rub shoulders every day with you, and that's how, that's what our relationship is. In our case, it's a very different paradigm. It's a very different story. you know, we need, there is something called customer experience, there is something called customer experience management, and then there is how do you exceed that customer experience expectation, you know. So for us, the biggest thing which when we started was, what are the category gripes, category truths, as we say. Remove the irritants, okay? Offer as much transparency as possible. And third thing is, listen. Listen to the consumer. Use it as a currency, okay? So for us, that was the starting point, you know, and that is how Rapido has started making a difference, you know, and that was the cornerstone of how we started evolving. We took baby steps. We are not the best. You know, there are so-called syndicated players in the market like Uber, you know, who operate across the globe, you know, who stand for, they really stand and carry the cross for consumer experience. But I think what Rapido has done is the best part of localization in the consumer experience side. So, you know, we are proud to bring that local aspect to the consumer experience angle. And that's what we are proud of.
That's a very interesting point, because when you talk about personalization, like maybe a doctor touched upon it, saying that it's personalization to every person, and you're talking about a personalization which is regional based. And when I come back to Vanda also, she'll agree upon saying that for whatever categories which she handled, PIN code level also matters a lot, because we are talking about a different attribute of calling a meat or a fish in different languages depending on the kind of people whom we have. So coming back to you, Ankur, like, you have a legacy brand. I mean, like, it's been there for decades, and if I go back to my home also, it has like been the brand for the generations which I remember. So for you, when, like, what I'm picking up from what Pavan said, listening to the consumer and creating an innovation, like right now you have come out with a beautiful innovation of Lidup, if I'm pronouncing.
There are a lot of innovations. Yes, Flip-On is what you're talking about.
Something which talks a lot from a safety perspective. And to me, like, the art of closing a cooker is salt. So how well do you listen to your customers in terms of creating that innovation or even the product which you're thinking from a futuristic perspective?
Okay. So any product that comes out, right? We all are in the business. Any product that comes out addresses either a need of the consumer or solves a pain point of the consumer, right? So all our innovations are directed towards solving consumer pain points. So all are consumer-centric innovations. Now we can go back and say, I have created something and it should sell, or consumers should adopt it. It never happens. Because if you are not solving a need, if you are not solving a pain point of the consumer will never pick up your product, will not engage with you. That's stated, right? So when we do products, when we did Flip-On, we did Swatch pressure cookers, and pressure cooker is one part of our business, but it came out from a consumer pain point across the country, and we do a lot of, I mean, engagement, a lot of focus groups, a lot of listening to the consumers from the kitchens and all of that stuff. One unique problem came out stating that, okay, pressure cookers froth, it froths and it's a problem. I don't see it as a problem, it's the nature of the cooker, right? So that's when we came up with something called a Swatch lid, where it controls the froth. Then we said, okay, these are need-based innovations. So this went a long way in saying, creating the differentiation. Then there's an aspiration-based and societal-based needs that the consumers directly or indirectly state when they're engaging with you, right? And it's brand agnostic. So then it said that, okay, in society, I have something, and in India, it generally happens that I did this, I bought this sari, I bought this uniform, I bought this car, I have this mobile, right, I have this car. There is a flaunting value, a societal value for a certain section of the society. And that's where we said that there is a room to get convenience as a part of their needs. So when I started, I said health, convenience. And so these are large aspects which are driving a lot of product-based categories today. And there is a societal value, obviously. Tech is a separate part to it, a big part to it. But these are the two inherent needs which bring in. That's where Flip-On came in as a need. And likewise, we had many other innovations. Induction, example, a lot of the parts in the country. People, I don't know how many of us know that induction-based cooking is a big way of alternate cooking in India, right? Then we said the slabs in the India with apartments coming up, slabs are becoming smaller and smaller and smaller, right? So you can't have two sources of cooking in the same slab. You don't have so much of space. That's when we came up with a hybrid gas stove, where you have a fire and an electrical cooktop together. Okay, no one believed it could happen, but then we did it, and there's a huge acceptance, and consumers are loving it. So likewise, any efforts towards solving those pain points, any efforts towards giving a societal value to the consumer is something that has to click. I mean, it's a time-tested thing, so that's what we go by.
So when you talk about a pain point, that's another one which leads to innovation and the tech evolution in whatever form. Now coming to Girish, like for you, my basic question is like, is it Route Mobile or Route Mobile?
Very interesting. Allow me, I'll try to make an attempt here.
No, is it?
I'll try to make, probably. It's very important because Rajdeep Gupta is our CEO, who founded, who basically bootstrapped it with 1 lakh rupees from his single bedroom. And he was spirit, he was passion, he was a marathon guy. After 18 years, he listed on BSE and NSE. And it's local to global. We are called Route Mobile.
Route Mobile.
Right? Route Mobile. Right? Okay. That's a desi we would always love to carry, but we serve global brands.
So coming to Route Mobile, which is again a global company, which has solved a lot of problem statements, because when I come from a telecom perspective, the days were there when we used to have the outbound callers, dialers, like your SMS, which has now taken a very technologically driven, standby in terms of how it has evolved. And I think you're solving a big piece when it looks up from a marketer's perspective in terms of personalization, whether it's your WhatsApp communication. And I think you have more than 3,000 plus active customers today with whom you serve and give personalized solutions. So what was that pain point which drove in terms of a tech, and how are you solving the technology? If you can come up with one example, it'll be really interesting for the panelists and the audience.
I'll try to make an attempt again here. So many brands, so many use cases, but let me take it D2C as any use case. Probably I'll try to make an attempt there, right? Today, if you see, right, if you go to any website or a mobile app, user, right, there are two things what personally I believe. When a user is reaching your website or a mobile app, he has an intent to do some commerce over it, right? And now, as I said, user is moving towards inspiration commerce, if you see, right? Now, what is the difference between intent and inspiration? What I feel is that intent is he wants to buy a single product, it comes, okay, for a brand. But when it comes to inspiration, right, when you really inspire him, he is going to invest more to you, okay? As a technology point from the back end, what we see, right, at WhatsApp, we have a feature called catalog feature, right, where brands can bring all their products into catalog. Okay, and do the recommendation on the real-time basis based on the intent and then inspire him to make that purchase. And what we have also did at the back end is that entire experience is very, very seamless. He can look at the product catalog, okay, he can put it in the cart, make a purchase, right? Within less than 2-3 steps, okay, you're boom, you're done. Then post that, we basically go back and then do the conversation again, get the feedback, okay, give back to the brands, okay, easy access to make a judgmental decision whether it's a zero cart or is really a loyalty customer where you'll have to go ahead and do cross-sell and upsell, okay. We bring that omni-channel element, try to reach out to him multiple channels. There is advanced channels today like WhatsApp and RCS where we can use a lot of their capabilities. When you bring the tools to the useful, right, it actually brings out the lot better ROI for any brands. That's what we have did for most of the brands today you talk about, right? They use our tools in a better way. They generate better ROI. They engage the customer in the right way. They know that when to connect, where to connect, how to connect, what kind of personalizations you will have to send, okay? There are a lot of template-based campaigns which goes out during the festive season or holiday season. We have seen a lot of impact coming in from all the brands.
So when you talk about seamless, like Pavan, see, it's a segment which you rightly said you're carrying or taking Bharat and mobility to a very different segment altogether. Because if I may use the word that you pioneered the art of moto cabs in India, for that matter, you regularized it. There were some pockets in different cities and states which were coming across. But having said that, like there were a lot of challenges which you faced. And I personally, I'm a advocate of your services because in our office, like we recently shifted from Koramangala to Belandur. So the biggest problem statement was traffic. after 4:30, 5 o'clock, I'm not sure how many of you are coming from that side. Cab, absolutely impossible. And people used to wrap up by 4:30 saying, boss, aaj gaadi nahi milega. All of a sudden, I saw an ad which Rapido put across saying that 50 rupees for you if you don't get the ride in 5 minutes. I took a screenshot, sent it on my WhatsApp group. Now, if you don't get a ride, send me the screenshot because I'm going to hold Pawan responsible. And trust me, till date, I've not got a single screenshot. So I think that deserves a big applause for people who are in Bangalore to understand the pain point. Thank you, sir. So Pawan, for me, the question is, while we all talk about personalization, emotional connect, and the way we serve, but this problem, what you're trying to solve, I'm 100% sure you're using tech to a different degree to ensure that a person is available within 5 minutes within the locality to be picked up, and that also with all right reasons. So how is that helping? I mean, how are you doing that in the organization?
Basically, you want the complete blueprint of my business. we call it EUCI. Basically, the full form is Unified Customer and Consumer Intelligence. That's the starting point which we use. We have a single view of our consumer and customer. Please let me explain to you. We call our riders as captains. People who drive you, we call them captains. They are our customers. And the people who consume our service are consumers, obviously. So we are proud to say that we have a unified intelligence on both the sides, you know. And trust me, if your captain is happy, you are happy. So we start with the captain. You know, that's the cornerstone of Rapido's philosophy, because we take that angle very seriously. With that angle, we have done multiple things, but having said that, you know, once you have that particular view, we know how to segment the captain. We know how to segment the consumer. You know, we have captains who have a very unique need state. You know, they want to work in a particular territory. We call it a mobility corridor, micro corridor. That I will work only in this corridor. If you give me orders in this particular corridor, his fulfillment, as we call it, servicing of the orders, is 100%. But as soon as you give him an order outside that micro mobility corridor, you know, the ifs and buts start coming. You know, he might accept, he might not accept. You know, so that's from the captain side. From the consumer side, you know, what does a consumer want? You know, we exactly know what is an ETA, expected time of arrival, which augurs well with Andy. You know, he will not wait for more than 5 minutes for a ride. So when at the back end, when we are doing that matching, you know, that personalization matching, if an order comes from Andy's side, we make sure that, you know, we allocate something, we match his request to a captain who can service him in next 5 minutes, you know. So we have both the silos, and people call them silos, we have both the things which are completely seamlessly integrated. You know, that's how we, you know, and one is getting you a ride in 5 minutes. Other is getting you the right captain. Okay, that because we take pride in saying that, boss, we will give you a captain who is only 4.8 and above rated on our system. So getting you a right captain. Once I accept the ride, I should not be canceling the ride. The captain should not cancel the ride. Okay. Once the ride has been accepted and not canceled, his ETA arrival has to be exactly, because otherwise I tend to, break my promise. And after that, when your ride once takes off, you know, how are you completely monitoring that ride end to end? You know, so I exactly know that, you know, Andy took a ride from Kormangla to Belandur. When did he take a ride? With whom did he take a ride? How many stops did Andy have? Were they exactly in the same order of the ELGO, which says that, boss, traffic light allows you 30 seconds, 45 seconds, 1 minute? If anything goes wrong, if there's deviation from that particular playbook, you know, we get signals. So we get onto the level that, you know, we exactly know what where and how to take care of Andy. So I think that's what we do. And likewise, we know exactly what, where and how to tackle our captains also. So I think it's a marriage which we have been able to have, and that's what Rapido is all about.
That's something which is tough to do, especially in the segment which you're managing. And that's another person like on the panel, which is Dr. Ashish also, who manages another segment similar to this, but on a very different profile. Like when you're talking about Narayana or even your previous stint of Medibuddy post-COVID, you talked about personalization where you created opportunity for people to have doctors accessible within the shortest period in whatever form it could be, whether it's physical visits or virtual, and you really narrated it in a very different form. So when you look at it from a segment perspective, while on a like a blueprint, if you put it, the process or the business org chart remains the same, but the persona of both these ones is entirely different. There also time is of critical essence. Like criticality is not something which can be picked across from an app. So how did you manage that, especially in a journey where, as you rightly pointed out, personalization between each person is equally important, because the emotional connect between the doctor and the patient is also critical. Like earlier, there was a time when there was a family doctor and the family doctor knew the overall history, 5 minutes, ho gaya. But now it's changed. And depending on the criticality and the options, you need to visit multiple doctors. But again, on a click, you're allowing the person to personalize it and create a narrative within the short form. So how did you manage it, doctor?
See, it's an industry where your needs and wants, everything blur, because at the end of the day, it's about taking care of somebody's health. So it becomes far more important in terms of solving each case by case. So just like how Pavan was also mentioning, how he was also mentioning that we listen to our customers. Similarly, while you are having a relationship with any of the healthcare or a hospital brand, you leave a lot of data footprint with them in terms of your test, in terms of your conversations with your doctors, and all of this has been digitized already now. Like Rapido knows how many times I'm doing a break. That is the kind of information you started to having as a relationship, and now it's very hard to find family doctor as a concept. It's becoming more of family hospitals, to be saying that, because I keep going to this place, and all of the industry have started having their own HIS. So for instance, for us, we have our own homegrown HIS where we are, in a way, collecting the data points for you and making meaningful conversations with you when you go meet the doctor next time. So they are able to see it through our EMR journeys, which is electronic medical records, and you are noting down what is the next step for that patient in their disease management or non-disease management journeys. Even not only this is just one, there are other ways where personalization or at least technology helping deliver a better experience for a patient is, there is a lot of things that are need to be done as a surround while giving you a disease management ecosystem. So imagine if somebody is in ICU earlier, or a normal frame of work is doing, is that the doctor has to go for rounds and see them then and there, how are their parameters working. But for us, we have our doctor app, which is Adi. You don't really need to come visit physically the ICU. You can always keep seeing their parameters. And the most of the heart attacks happen between the time of 2 a.m. to 5 a.m. in a hospital. That's as per studies, and it's a known fact also. So it kind of takes away that kind of adversities as well, and it solves for a better experience. Similarly, for, I don't want anyone to go to a hospital, but when you do, you see the healthcare professionals are writing a lot of papers. So that is also part of experience, because nurses or our healthcare professionals are supposed to take care of you, not invest too much of time and kind of paper, because that's required by the guidelines also. So we build up Nama, which is a nursing app, which allows them to digitize all of these things. And all of these records, one pulled together, sits on top of giving you, saying, for instance, allowing us to say that you don't need an operation. I can actually cure you by putting you under a program where I can stop you eating, taking a lot of sugars or doing regular exercises so that you don't end up on the OT table. So that's how your personalization works. That's how your technology helps you a better experience for us.
No, that's, as you rightly said, it's something which is like very close to anybody's work, matter like when you talk about health. And another sector which we can talk about is glamour. It also has its own, what do you call, ups and downs. But of late, if you look at it, the personalization has taken to a very different layer. Now, you spoke about earlier about Licious. Now, you're talking about skincare, where it is earlier was a shampoo, which is more from a, what do you call, one or two segments. Now, it's personalized to, you name it, even personalized as per your name and whatever that you input. So, in your side of it, I have seen a lot of innovations which you have done in terms of not only from a customer experience perspective, I would say it's more about giving them the loyalty factor and connecting more on an emotional quotient, which is something which gets missed when you personalize a lot, because today consumers have technically become more of testers. Like earlier there were certain brands, when you talk about the toothpaste or what you call hair cream or whatever, there were three or four which you're loyal to. You go pick up, but today, thanks to the medias in terms of like how we market, options are plenty. And people have also have the habit of now experimenting. So how are you as a brand creating that? Because of late in the last 6 to 8 months, when I go through your products, the SKUs and the way you'll be marketing, there's a lot of loyalty, emotional connect which you're building.
Interesting question. Consumers are changing, as we know, and they're changing at a very rapid pace. We've seen a lot of tectonic shifts happening during COVID. So it's not the same anymore, and therefore being abreast of trends and solving for the consumer is very important, and therefore D2C brands, insurgent brands like Wow Skin Science actually stand out. So all of us who've been marketeers and consumer marketeers, we know this term called MOUB, most often used brand. It's been in our tracks, etc. So what we see in a certain category, right? These are the brands you typically, most of the consumers use for that need. For example, in biscuits, say in cookies or Mari, or in shampoos, in dandruff shampoos, etc. But that doesn't really hold true, because right now there's a lot of fragmentation actually happening because consumers are seeking more. If we notice, right, on our bathroom shelves, once upon a time there used to be one shampoo, two shampoos. Now you see the plethora of shampoos which are actually there. So you see how categories also have been segmented. There is hair fall, there is dandruff. But today's time and age, we see so many innovations, we see so many options available. And I think brands like Wow Skin Science actually have made the best of it. And we need to delight the consumer and figure out these micro opportunities which are actually there and make them big. So we have curly hair, we have frizzy hair, we have, colored hair of a certain type. So therefore, you have offerings right now which are really, really efficacious, which actually, solve for consumer needs. So I think that is innovation. I can give you another example at Wow. We were launching, we were getting ready for summer. And the biggest category which booms at that point of time is sunscreens. Studying the market, we realize, right, there are a lot of offerings right there, but the penetration of the category is just 2%. So there is something which is an opportunity which can be cracked. And what we realize is everyone saying the same thing. It is SPF, it is no white cast, etc. But we know our skin types are different. No one has really spoken to us about, a sunscreen for dry skin, for oily skin, for combination skin. And there was a huge opportunity there. And for the first time, we actually launched sunscreens for different skin types. And no one had actually seen that. And that actually was a good, a good learning. It did really well. And I think the online business really, really took off. So I think personalization is important. I can give you another example. It's a very interesting example I was speaking with Andy about, and it's the meat and seafood industry, right? We know it's like dialect. It changes every 30 kilometers. A Bengali eats fish in a different way, which a Goan eats, a Malayali eats, right? All of them have their own nuances. And what we see is from a customization perspective, from a brand side, you can identify different clusters where, you know, certain ethnicities live. For example, Kamanahalli will have more Malayalis, Indranagar may have more Bengalis and North Indians, etc. So basis a hub type, you actually have a selection which is relevant to the ethnicity which stays there. So what happens as a brand, you are more specific, you have less wastage, your sales go up. What happens as a consumer, right? I see my relevant cuts, I see the fish which I actually like, and therefore I buy. So on both sides, actually, this is optimized if you actually customize your offerings to the prevailing need. Another example I can give you is of coffee. I worked at Third Wave Coffee. And what we realized is at different catchment areas, right, there are different types of consumers who actually come. For example, in transit clusters or in tech parks, right, people are just coming for a quick coffee. Portion sizes are small. They want certain kinds of, say, an espresso or a cappuccino or an Americano, right? Whereas if you see in shopping areas or in malls, etc., people want to sit and, you know, take some bit of time. So therefore, more indulgent drinks actually work. So pricing, range and assortment, all this is very relevant to where you're actually selling to be able to be relevant to the consumer and also make money.
It's quite interesting, actually, because when you talk about options, now today we are lost in terms of, like, what do we need to select? And again, when it comes across in terms of medium, especially coming back to Ishiga, see, hyperlocal targeting is something which you call it as your forte. It becomes even more important because the vicinity, which we heard Pavan also talking about, how that locality matters to even to a captain and even to a rider. And that's the same when you're talking about from a consumer perspective. I'm talking custom consumer as your end client to whom you are showing the ads in whatever mediums which is possible. So why, how do you feel that when the hyper targeting ROI becomes far more higher, because obviously you're targeting on a very super focused kind of a laser gun. How does the brands react to it? Like, because it needs a lot of difference in terms of how they communicate. It can't be a umbrella of communication which has been drifted in saying that, okay, you do this on this pin code, you do this on this mall, you do this on a hospital. Which I'm assuming that you do a lot of hyperlocal targeting based on the place where they are also. So can you throw some light on that?
Sure, Andy. So I totally agree with you, and I'm agreeing with all the panelists out here. That's personalization is really important for every aspect. You know, you mentioned about pin code. I'll just give a very small example here. A telco brand had come to us and they wanted to reach out to users in different pin codes itself. So what we had actually done is we used a dynamic creative using dynamic creative optimization. And each and every user was served a different communication basis their pin codes. So say, for example, in Delhi, if you're in 001, a 01 user will have a different communication versus a 02 user will have a different communication, a 03 will have a different communication, and the entire creative looked the same. It was just dynamically the creative was changing as per the pin code. So we were doing it from the back end. That in turn led to a lot of users creating a lot of buzz and asking a lot of questions, and the telco wanted to ask them to upgrade their plans. They actually got back to us telling us that they've got like 5% of the users who actually came to the stores, and they spoke of how can we upgrade our plan because the solutions were customized. So personalization works really well when it comes to creating brand results for the particular brand, be it telco. And on a very separate note, like if you all remember a couple of years ago, Cadbury had done this ad where Shah Rukh Khan was popularizing their store for each and every user. You guys remember that, right? So it was also an extreme level of personalization where a big star like Shah Rukh Khan was actually promoting their particular store. It was a huge success where Mondelez had clubbed in and they were talking about the fact that naya shop khula hai, chalo kuch meetha ho jaye. Right, so I think personalization has worked wonders in all the fields, be it retail, be it, as she said, be it retail, be it auto, be it the health sector, be it household brands, be it FMCG. It's everywhere, you know, like.
Thanks, Ishiga. Like, while we try and wrap it up as soon as possible, because time is also running out, I'll quickly come back to you, each one of you, once again, in terms of what are the one or two keywords which you would want the audience to pick across and concentrate on? Because we will have a lot of, startups, a lot of people who are looking at you and thinking like, hey, while it's easier to say I need to personalize, I need to create a customer experience which stays along with the brand. What, and now technology, when you talk about it, you can talk about an AI, ML, AVR, AR, it's plenty. But what would be that one or two keywords from your personal experience which would say that, hey, concentrate on this, make that as your magic keyword, put it on the board out there. That needs to be a part of your, whatever that you're thinking from a customer perspective for a brand. So maybe I can start with Ankur.
Okay, I'll take it. So we have to create, just an advice here, what we have followed. We create consumer cohorts, okay? Large level of personalization starts there. Then you go to micros, with what she was saying, 30 kilometers, the dial exchange, right? But the 30 kilometers give you a certain segment and a certain hold of what you can do as a brand. So what's your scale? How much you want to scale as a company? Something that will define to what level of personalization you want to go. What technology has done one thing, it has made the life easier, okay? It's made life easier for consumers, for brand, it's made the ability of, it's created businesses, obviously, but then it's, what it's doing is, it's solving consumer needs, or consumer wants, as we may call it, right? And the consumer has to be at the fulcrum of whatever one wants to do. Creating experiences is something that goes a long way. One advice for a lot of tech startups and companies is that we tend to get into the patent thing a lot, right? We have created it, let's patent it.
How many patents are there?
Sorry?
How many patents do you have as org?
As an org, we have more than 300 odd, but then
wow.
I'm not a believer of patent because it what it does is just brings your two things. It restricts your competition to come in, and second, it increases your ability to charge a premium or to recruit customers, right? I'm a believer that you should not have patents so that the adoption goes up, and when the adoption goes up, you being the you get a first mover's advantage, you get also gets an advantage because you have created it. So be customer centric, okay? Be local is something that always helps a brand. That's my advice. That's how I would like to
Centric, be local. One quick question, follow-up question is, when you said cohorts, what is the craziest cohort which you ever got?
What is the?
Craziest cohort.
Craziest cohort.
Yeah, because when you're talking about customers, you have literally broken it down into like different segments, right?
Right.
What is that one cohort which you said, wow, this is like out of the box kind?
Okay. So we, being a very mass company, generally don't get into all of that, but yes, in terms of crazy cohorts, customer comes up with some kind of needs. Example, women of the household, right? When we were trying to see where we can expand as a business, what came across was what, as an alignment for a kitchen brand, what would you think? What is the next alignment where you can get into? Then the only thing which came up was that cleaning solutions. Okay, the bathroom. And now how does the kitchen and bathroom go together? Now the insight to that is the homemaker, and I'll not call it women, I'm not. So the homemaker is largely involved in two major aspects of when they take care of the home. It's the health of the family, right? The health of the family starts with kitchen and then gets into bathroom, which is cleaning of the household. When it's not only bathroom, but cleaning of the house. So cleaning solution became a natural extension. But then, before getting into that, we never thought that that was consumer in, right? And that surprised us. That did well for us also as a business, I mean, because it was the same consumer that we're talking to. But then before getting into it, it was surprising that it came across as an opportunity.
Thanks, Ankur. Thanks, Gopi. Doctor, what is your one key takeaway which you would want to leave it with the audience today?
So, yes, technology is there to solve our lives and for brands, but I think us and people in this room, we make it complicated. So rather than having those fancy charts up on the board and showcasing, I would suggest take baby steps, keep it simple. And if you're not too much bending on saying that I've covered the entire chart by creating that flow diagram of the cohort from this to T minus or T plus 30, keep it simple, you will definitely roll it over.
That's a very important one as well. So we have be customer centric, be local, be simple. Now, Girish, what is that which you want to add to it?
Very interesting. Seriously, very interesting. For me, I feel from technology, it's a springboard for me. Okay, you choose the right technology player who has a global reach, agility, scalable, who has worked on basically rise of Gen AI is playing a very, very important role, not on the monetization side, at least on the automation side. Rise of Gen AI plays very, very important role. Choose the right technology player who has the right springboard, who is going to help you reach personalization, segmentation, CAC. Today, brand does not need only read ratio, right? They need a click ratio. They need a replay ratio to make a better decisions. They need the right graphs, right? They want everything to be personalized in such a way that it helps them to drive revenues, right? Choose the right technology, I would say, who has the springboard, global reach, who can really help you grow in your business, I would say, are the key takeaways.
That's very important even in a life, like it's like choosing your right partner. Like I think choosing the right partner from a business perspective also is equally important. So we have be local, be simple, choose the right partner. Yes.
I don't know what to say. They've covered everything then.
Really?
I think I will stick to innovation then in that case.
Innovation. Okay,
of course,
be innovative.
I mean, if he's, like Ashish says, you have to be simple, then I don't know how. Innovation is also important, right? How will we get the customers on board? Exactly. So I think I would stick to the word of innovation because as salespeople here, all we hear from our brands is like, kuch naya karte hain, kuch innovation karte hain, kuch naya karna hai, award chahiye, kuch to karo. I think innovation is also the key to capture the user's interest and how well can we, how well the brand can capture the user's interest, which in turn will lead for them to purchase consideration and eventually sales, right?
Thanks, Ishika. I think that's a perfect elimination of like your be simple and be innovative is what Vanda gave us an example earlier in terms of taking a just a meat product and creating a box and creating a story on it.
So I think Vanda, we could go well for Philips, simply innovative.
Yes.
Yes.
I would say insight. Insight is really very, very important. You'll always have technology as a medium to reach, to become efficient. You'll always have analysis of cohorting to be able to refine. But insight is very important. And I think I take what Ashish says, simplicity in actually being able to decode it is very, very important. So you have to be sharp, you have to be precise, and you have to be as close to, you know, what the consumer wants. So I think that sharpness is important. And I think being real, right? Ultimately, we sell to consumers. They like to hear a story. So if you can do that, triangulate insight with reality, which is contextual to what they are going through, what problem points they have, with a great story. I was speaking to Pavan and I said, you know, Rapido has so many stories to tell. They have 10,000?
10 lakh,
I stand corrected one, some decimals away. 10 lakh captains, right, who come from different strata, they're humans, right? They're coming from so many life stages. And imagine communicating that and the brilliant example which he gave about how tech is enabling that. So if you tell these stories, right, be real, I think you will have it going.
So be real, be insightful, be innovative. We are with the right partner and keeping it as simple as possible, and the more locally or the more focused you are, perfect. Pavan, you just need to tie to it together.
Okay. We have a very learned panel here. In Rapido, we just keep it very simple. There are only two keywords for us. One is transparency, other is responsiveness. Okay, that's what the consumer looks for in our humble opinion, because that's what they deal with, transparency and responsiveness. Behind the scenes, personalization, innovation, XYZ, it's all is very, very important. But I think there's a front side and then there's a back. There's the kitchen, you know, and then there's your drawing room. And we also feel that, you know, personalization to a good cause, Because super personalization is also super complicates things, you know. So we personally believe that, you know, there is something called personalization, but we are big fans of genericism. You know, this is a new philosophy which is there. Look for it. It's beautiful, you know. So personalization and genericism. So genericism, we, you know, play between that thing. So yeah, that's what we feel it is there. To sum it up, I think it's a difference between, and to each their own, but it is a difference between essentialism and minimalism. So, you know, you decide where you fall, how you do it, because there is no one single rule for anything.
So I think, like, from a overall perspective, when you look at it, it's customer at the center. At any given point in time, the day when you look at it from any business form, the day we miss out the customer from the heart of it, we tend to diversify and we tend to create problems which is unwanted. And from whatever that we heard from the panelists, I will leave it to you with a small story to wrap it up. I'm sure many of you would have heard it. How many of you have heard the Amazon story of Jeff leaving a chair on every meeting? I think I can see a couple of hands here. So what Jeff did is, from the day one, whether it's a board meeting, whether it's an internal meeting, in Amazon, if there is a meeting happening, there should be one chair left empty. And you know, who's it for? It's for the customer. So whatever you're deciding, while the customer might not be speaking for it, is it right by the customer? Is the customer in alignment to it? Is something which they ask for? And I think that's something which we also should think inward and outward, because we have internal clients, external clients, and what we need, as Pavan rightly said, we are all, each one of our own. We know our products, we know our system, we know what we are selling, whether it's technology at the best. And I think that's what we'll wrap it up with. Thank you so much, panelists. Thank you so much for the engaging time what we had. Thank you.